I'd like to do with you this morning is continue our study of the book of Ruth, if that's okay. We started this last weekend. We opened up the book of Ruth, and we considered what this story had to say to us. And so if you would, go ahead and grab your Old Testament, find the book of Ruth. You'll find it between the books of Judges and 1 Samuel. If you get to 1st, 2nd Kings and Chronicles, you've gone too far. Go back to the left a little bit there. While you're finding the book of Ruth, I should tell you that I think the book of Ruth is completely misnamed. We're calling it the wrong thing. It's not that big a deal, but, you know, precision is nice. Smile at me or something. Come on, give me something here. It's amazing how many things are misnamed. I was reading some information about misnamed things this week. Do you know that, do you know what a koala bear is? Huh? Those fuzzy little animals that hang out in eucalyptus trees in Australia. They're cute, right? I took a trip to Australia and brought my daughters home stuffed animals of koala bears. They're just beautiful little teddy bears. Be careful, though. I hear they'll rip your face off if you get too close. Or maybe that's chimpanzees. I'm not exactly sure. But just be careful around the koalas. Did you know that they're not really bears? Did you know this? Did you know this? No? No? Some? Yes? No? Actually, they're marsupials, which means they're more closely related to possums than bears. And possums are just gross. They're just gross. In fact, we're calling them the wrong thing, too. We should be just calling them big, giant rats, because that's all they are, and they're gross. But we're calling koala bears the wrong thing. They're not bears. I guess we just call them koalas. Add to your list of misnamed things the book of Ruth. The book of Ruth. Why do I say that? Well, because really, as you read through this story, you quickly discover that Ruth is really just the best supporting actress of this story. That there's somebody else who is the focus of this storyline. In fact, if the people who compiled the books of the Old Testament together had asked me what to call this book, I would have said this: call it the book of Naomi. Because Naomi really is the central character of this plotline. She's the one who the author is focusing on to help us see some things about the kind of God we worship. But the people who gathered the books of the Old Testament together, they didn't ask me my opinion on this. Of course, they did it 2,200 years ago, and I wasn't around. I like to think they would have asked if I had been, but it's probably delusions of grandeur there. But Naomi truly is the central character of the plot. It's her story, Naomi's story. After the prologue of the book of Ruth, the author sets up her problem, her dilemma, that he wants us to focus on throughout the rest of this book. Naomi and her husband Elimelech and her two sons are living away from the promised land in the country of Moab. And here's what happens in Ruth chapter 1, verse 3. But Elimelech, the husband of Naomi, died, and she was left with her two sons. They took Moabite wives. Thank you for that. Somebody remembering the gasp from last week. We had some fun. That message is online. You can check it out online. The name of one was Orpah, and the name of the other Ruth. And they lived there about 10 years. And both Mahlon and Chilion died, so that the woman was left without her two sons and her husband. The woman, Naomi, has a problem that needs to be solved. And the author wants us to focus on that problem because what he really wants us to see is how God orchestrates an amazing and beautiful solution to her problem. And he's going to tell us all about that throughout the rest of this book. What was her problem? Well, like we just read, her husband and her sons had died while she was in the far country of Moab, away from the promised land. She was a destitute widow, away from the protection of God's people, away from the protection of God's land. This at a time when widows were amongst the most vulnerable members of society. Back then, women had very little opportunity to take care of themselves. If they didn't have a husband or a father, they were left on their own, and they couldn't own things themselves. It was a difficult go for these ladies, and Naomi was one of these ladies, a destitute widow in a far country. Last weekend, we talked about how she got there to Moab. And for now, just let me say that Naomi's husband, Elimelech, had made some bad choices. I don't want to blast the guy, because that's not fair. But the book here tells us that he ran from God to the country of Moab. He should have repented. When God allowed famine to afflict the promised land during the time of Judges, God was trying to get Israel back on track, spiritually speaking. But instead of cooperating with that plan, Elimelech took his family and moved away from the promised land. He did what was right in his own eyes, and he moved to the enemy territory of Moab. Now, before we cluck our tongues at him and get all self-righteous, we probably should recognize that we do the same kinds of things at times. We find ourselves in uncomfortable situations, and we don't necessarily like the plan that God has laid out for our lives in any given moment. Sometimes we take matters into our own hands, don't we? And we devise plans and schemes to meet our own needs. Some of us stray into sins that deaden the pain. Some of us run to unhealthy relationships that we know are bad for us. Those are our far country. That's our Moab. That's where we go when we're not cool with the plans that God is working out in front of us in any given moment. And understand, it doesn't take much to stray from God's plan for us. You know that? It doesn't. I mean, we don't have to really move away, geographically speaking. In fact, it just takes us. Let's say God is standing right here next to me. All it takes to stray from God is to just do this. We turn our backs on the Lord sometimes. We're, like I said, we're not comfortable with the plans that he has laid out for us, and so we decide that we'll just meet our own needs. Straying from God will never end well for us, ever. Being right next to God is the safest place to be on the planet. Amen? And the farther we get from him, well, the greater the chance that something bad is going to happen. Straying from God didn't end well for Elimelech's family. I mean, you know what happened to the men in this story. But before that happened, Elimelech, his sons Mahlon and Chilion, Naomi, their wives, they missed out on God's correction and protection, the good blessings that God promised his people when they lived by his law in the promised land. And so after Elimelech died, and after her sons died, Naomi found herself in a tough situation. She had two young widowed daughters-in-law. She was by herself in this far country, and there was nobody to take care of them. They were desperate. And like I said, this was at a time when life was tough for widows. So what did Naomi do? We're going to read in just a moment that Naomi limped home. She limped home. Time spent in the far country will leave us with limps. You know that. Time spent in the far country always beats us up. Leaves us empty. Sometimes it leaves us with lasting scars or limps. But the good news here, right, the amazing thing about this is even with limps and scars, God always welcomes us back home. Amen? He always throws the doors open wide and welcomes those who have strayed back home. And God's going to welcome Naomi back home. Not only that, This story, Naomi's story, helps me understand something very important, something that I really want you to hear today. That is this. We find ourselves in a far country. We realize that we've strayed. Not only will God welcome us home, hear me, God will give us grace for our journey back home. That's what I want you to get out of today's time. If you're a note taker, this is the thing you write down. If someone asks you, what did Fergus preach on today? You say, God will always give us grace for the journey back home. Practice it with me. God will always give us grace for the journey back home. He absolutely will. And I know that's the case because as I read this story, I see God giving Naomi grace in two very specific ways. He does two very specific things for her that actually make her journey back home to him easier. And I want to talk about this grace that God gives Naomi this morning because I have to believe that God will do the exact same thing for us. We find ourselves far from him. God will give us the same kind of grace that he gave to Naomi. God will give us grace for our journey back home. Now, it occurs to me that before we discover Naomi's grace in this remarkable story, we might need to stop and take a moment to actually define grace. I know that many of you have been around Calvary for a long time, and you know that we love to talk about and sing about God's grace here at Calvary. Amen? Amen. We are big fans of the grace of God here. Big fans. But it occurs to me that some of the new folks here might not exactly know what we're talking about or singing about. I don't know if you've noticed this, folks, but if you look around, there are a lot of new faces among us. Easter weekend, 200 people got saved here at Calvary. And maybe they haven't quite heard a definition of grace. And so that word itself can seem kind of confusing. What do we mean by grace? Is that quick little prayer we pray right before we eat, right? Is it somebody's, you know, suaveness or something like that? Now, grace is something very specific. So let me explain it to those folks. And listen, if you are already a scholar of the grace of God, here's what you do now while I'm explaining this. You sit back and you bask in the awesomeness of the grace of God. All right? That's one thing you could do. Or, you could amen me at appropriate times as I explain all of this to reinforce what I'm saying. Is that okay? Amen. Awesome. Well, let me just start. Very quick explanation. It'll only take a minute or two. God's grace is usually defined as his unmerited favor. How many of you have heard that definition before? Look at all the hands. God's unmerited favor. And that's essentially what it is, but I think it's an worn-out definition, because we don't talk like that. Unmerited? What does that even mean? Well, here's how I define grace, because I like to keep things really, really simple. Grace is God's attitude of kindness toward us that demonstrates itself in mercy. Let me say it again. Grace is God's attitude of kindness towards us that demonstrates itself in mercy. God is kind to us. This is an appropriate place for an amen from you grace scholars. God is incredibly kind to us. And since God is kind to us, he doesn't always give us the punishment, the discipline we deserve when we stray into the far country. And when he doesn't give us what we deserve, that's mercy. That's God's grace. Now, on the other side of the grace equation, God gives us more good stuff than we deserve. Amen? Stuff like love and forgiveness. We didn't earn God's love. We certainly didn't earn his forgiveness, but he gives that to us. And that's his grace. Both sides of this equation are grace. And here's what I want you to understand. If we're lost in a far country, if we've strayed from this gracious God, he will give us grace for our journey home. He'll give us grace for that journey. What will that grace look like? Now, let me show you what it looks like in Naomi's story. And then we'll make connections to our lives. All right? First thing I want you to understand is this. The first way God demonstrates grace to Naomi as she makes her way back home to him is this: God is patient with Naomi's confused emotions. God is patient with Naomi's confused emotions. You see, Naomi was really confused about all the trouble she was living through. Fact, she thought all of this trouble was God's fault. Look at Ruth 1:13 with me. About halfway through the verse, Naomi is in a conversation with Orpah and Ruth, and she's telling her daughters-in-law to go back to their parents. She can't take care of them, and she's got to go home. Of course, Orpah will go. Ruth will cling to her. But look at what Naomi says here. About halfway through verse 13, she says, "No, my daughters, you go home. For it is exceedingly bitter to me for your sake that the hand of the Lord has gone out against me." The hand of the Lord has gone out against me. Naomi believed that all of this bad stuff that was happening to her, the death of her husband, the deaths of her sons, her destitute status in a foreign, she believed that all of this stuff was happening to her because God was trying to ruin her life. In her pain, she was confused. In fact, if you go down a few more verses to verse 19, in the meantime there, Naomi and Ruth actually make the journey back to Bethlehem. And when they get to the village of Bethlehem, it's been about 10 years since Naomi was there. They step into the town square. Everybody sees her. There's just kind of a big ruckus. And then Naomi explains herself, and in two verses here, three actually, she's going to explain where she's been and what's happened to her, to these ladies, and in doing so, she's going to hurl some pretty harsh accusations at the God of the universe. Look at them, starting with verse 19. So the two of them, that's Naomi and Ruth, went on until they came to Bethlehem, and when they came to Bethlehem, it's in Judah, the promised land. The whole town was stirred because of them, and the women said, "Is this Naomi?" And she said to them, "Do not call me Naomi." Naomi is a name that means pleasant. "Do not call me Naomi, call me Mara." Mara is a name that means bitter. "Call me Mara, for the Almighty has dealt very bitterly with me. I went away full, and the Lord has brought me back empty. Why call me Naomi when the Lord has testified against me and the Almighty has brought calamity upon me?" This pleasant lady who they knew 10 years earlier comes back just bitter. And you can see that her bitterness is rooted in her confusion over why all of this stuff is happening to her. And she points the finger directly at God. Look at her accusations. I count four of them. Verse 19, she says, "God has dealt bitterly with me. He's been mean to me. He's been harsh to me." She's saying, all of this stuff has happened to me because God is cruel. She goes on to say, "God brought me home empty. I went away full. I had a life. I had a husband. I had sons. I had a future. And God has taken all of that away from me," she's saying. "He did this." The next accusation she brings against God is when she says, "God has testified against me." It's as if she sees God as some, you know, cosmic prosecuting attorney just throwing charge after charge at her. She's saying, "God's not on my side. God has destroyed me." And then that last accusation, did you catch it there in verse 21? "God has brought calamity upon me." She's saying to her old friends, "All of this death that surrounds me, all of this poverty that I'm struggling with, God did this. All of this pain is God's fault." This is some pretty rough accusations against the God of the universe. Naomi believed that God had ruined her life. that's clear something up, because some of you might be thinking right now, well, wait a second, Fergus, isn't God responsible for all of this trouble that Naomi's dealing with? Not really. I mean, I can understand why you might think that, but not really. What you need to know is that God had promised that if his people lived in a close relationship with him in the promised land, he would bless them. He would make them prosper. He would protect them. But if they stepped out of that close relationship, if they wandered away from God, if they stepped out from under his umbrella of blessing and protection, they were probably going to get rained on in life. That's what Elimelech did. He stepped out of the blessing and protection of life with God in the promised land. And when he did that, he stepped away from the safest place on the planet, which is right next to God. Amen? Bad things did not happen to Naomi because God was out to get her. Bad things happened because Elimelech made choices that led his family away from God's blessing and protection in the promised land. And that's probably something that we need to hear. That's something that we need to be clear on as well. When bad stuff happens to us, don't think that God is trying to ruin your life. Because he loves you. He is gracious and patient in all of those good things. But sometimes, not always, okay, please, I'm not saying always, but sometimes the bad stuff happens in our lives because God is simply respecting our choices. We choose a path that leads us away from God. God doesn't want us to go there. He's not daring us to go there. But when we walk down that path, God respects that choice. He won't turn our brains off. Sometimes we wish he would. Amen? Because he can see where this is taking us. Sometimes we wish he'd just kind of override what we call our will, our decision-making ability, and make us make the right decisions. But God respects us. He respects our choices. And when we make choices that lead us away from him, there are consequences to those choices. And sometimes God allows us to deal with those consequences. Naomi was confused on all this. She was confused, and so she lashed out at God. She lashed out at him in pain and anger. Pain does that to us, you know. Clouds our thinking. Makes us do things that we normally wouldn't do. Pain can explode in anger. You know, maybe at the people who love us the most. Or maybe God himself. But the good thing is that God is compassionate and gracious and kind. Amen? In fact, Psalm 86:15 tells us that God is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger. That means patient. He's slow to anger and abounding in love. In fact, we see that those words used to describe God all over the Old Testament. Gracious, compassionate, slow to anger, abounding in love. And so God was patient with Naomi when she starts hurling these accusations at God. And I'm really glad of that, aren't you? And I'm really glad that God wasn't easily offended by Naomi's accusations. Can you imagine if he had been? He is up in heaven. He's like, wait, Naomi said what about me? Zap. And the book of Ruth is over at like verse 21 of chapter 1, and it's really short. And we read it, and we're like, what happened? And we walk away thinking that the message of the book of Ruth is don't offend God or else. Cosmic zap. But that's not the message of the book of Ruth. The message is a message of grace and compassion. God's patience with Naomi in her time of pain was a gift of grace. And I'm glad that God is that way, because there are times when our pain drives us to talk out of turn about God. When tough stuff happens to us sometimes, often we get confused. We begin pointing fingers up, blaming God for the trouble that we're dealing with and saying things like, God, why did you let this happen to me? The Bible says you're loving, but no, you're not. And in those moments, God doesn't zap us, even though our careless words deserve that. Instead, God is merciful and patient. That's this side of the grace equation that we talked about. God doesn't give us what we deserve on this end. We deserve the zap, but he's patient and merciful. But God's grace doesn't stop there in Naomi's story. In fact, it goes well beyond that. You see, when Naomi and Ruth returned to the promised land, they had absolutely nothing. I mean, sure, they were back in the land that God had promised to his people and in a position to experience his blessing and his protection there, but they were still destitute, essentially homeless, with nothing. People who have nothing need the grace of God. And God knows that. And so he gave the grace of God to these ladies. Here's the second way God demonstrates his grace to Naomi and Ruth. God gave Naomi and Ruth more than they deserved on their journey back home. Remember, we've seen he didn't give them this side of the discipline. And what we're going to see now is that God is going to bless them abundantly. He's going to abundantly provide for Naomi and Ruth in their time of need. Let me show you this in the text here. Ruth chapter 2, verse 1. They're back in Bethlehem. It's at the time of the barley harvest. Verse 1, now Naomi had a relative of her husband's, a worthy man of the clan of Elimelech, whose name was Boaz. You're going to like Boaz. As this story proceeds, you're really going to like this guy. And Ruth, the Moabite, said to Naomi, let me go to the field and glean among the ears of grain after him in whose sight I shall find favor. Let me go out to the fields and maybe somebody will let me glean in their fields. And so she, Ruth, set out and went and gleaned in the fields after the reapers. And she happened to come to the part of the field belonging to Boaz, who was of the clan of Elimelech. Let me tell you what's going on here because it's kind of strange. This is the barley harvest time, and people who owned land, they're out there and they're harvesting their crops. Usually the men would go ahead and beat the stalks of grain that would fall off, and then the women would come along behind and pick up the grains of barley and collect them. That's how they harvested back then. But Ruth wants to glean the fields. Let me explain to you what's happening there. Ruth and Naomi don't have a field to harvest. And so one of the things that God required of farmers in the promised land was to leave a little extra behind in the harvest so that the neediest, the most vulnerable members of society could come along after all the harvest had taken place and they could collect the leftovers, the scraps, so that they could at least stay alive in the promised land. You following me? In fact, God gave some laws that demanded that his people do that. Let me show you some of those real quick. Turn back to the left and go to Deuteronomy chapter 24. Deuteronomy 24. See, God wanted the nation of Israel to be a people who cared about the most vulnerable members of society. And he'll lump them together, the three most vulnerable members of society, over and over and over in the law. We're in the law now, the first five books of the Bible. And God identified the most vulnerable members of society at this time as the fatherless. Those are orphans. As widows. And as the sojourner. The foreigner. The immigrant. Look what God requires of his people towards these folks. Deuteronomy 24:19. When you reap your harvest in your field and forget a sheaf in the field, some of the harvest, you shall not go back to get it. It shall be for the sojourner, the fatherless, and the widow, that the Lord your God may bless you in all the works of your hands. Don't pick up every little piece. Leave some behind for people who don't own a field. Verse 20, when you beat your olive trees, they'd beat the branches, the olives would fall off. You shall not go over them again. Don't beat those trees twice, God is saying. It shall be, the leftovers shall be for the sojourner, the fatherless, and the widow. When you gather the grapes of your vineyard, you shall not strip it afterwards. It shall be for the sojourner, the fatherless, and the widow. Do you see what the Lord is doing? He's making sure that the people who are most needy and vulnerable in Israelite society are taken care of, that they at least have the legal right to pick up the scraps after everybody's taken everything else. That's what Ruth wants to do. She wants to go to the fields to pick up the scraps so that she and Naomi could have something to eat. I mean, Naomi and Ruth, they were both widows, right? Ruth is an immigrant. That's kind of a double whammy against her. Very vulnerable. But watch this. Watch how God does this, because God is going to give them more than they deserve. He's going to go beyond the requirement of the law. Remember, what they deserve is just the scraps. But watch what God does. Starting with verse 4, we read, and behold, Boaz, oh, you're going to like this guy, came from Bethlehem, and he said to the reapers, the Lord be with you. And they answered, the Lord bless you. Oh, he loves the Lord. You like this guy already, don't you? Huh? You're like, eh, not really. Come on, people. Boaz is a good guy. Then Boaz said to his young man who was in charge of the reapers, whose young woman is this? He sees Ruth. And the servant who was in charge of the reapers answered, she is the young Moabite woman who came back with Naomi from the country of Moab. She said, please let me glean and gather among the sheaves after the reapers. She wants the scraps. So she came and she has continued from early morning until now, except for a short rest. And then Boaz said to Ruth, now listen, my daughter, do not go to glean in another field or leave this one, but keep close to my young women. You see what Boaz just did? He said, hey, Ruth, you don't have to go scavenging anymore. You stay right here. In fact, you go along with my young women. You were picking up the scraps as they harvested. What I want you to do is you just work right alongside of them. See what he's done? He continues, let your eyes be on the field that they are reaping. You go after them. Actually means with them. And have I not charged the young men not to touch you? Because immigrant women had very little rights, very little protections. God, Boaz is charging his men to watch out for her. And when you are thirsty, go to the vessels and drink what the young men have drawn. Then Ruth fell on her face, bowing to the ground, and said to him, why have I found favor in your eyes that you should take notice of me, since I am a foreigner? But Boaz answered her, all that you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband, talk of the town, what happened to these folks? All that you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband has been fully told to me, and how you left your father and mother and your native land and came to the people that you did not know before. The Lord repay you for what you've done, and a full reward be given you by the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings, whose umbrella, you have come to take refuge. You see what Boaz did for this lady? Boaz went above and beyond the law for Ruth and Naomi. He gave them more than the law required. He kept the law. She was picking up the scraps, but he elevates her to status as one of his own young women. And not only that, if we had the time, we'd read the rest of this chapter and we'd see that later in the day, Boaz feeds her lunch, make sure that she's okay, gives her extra stuff to take home to Naomi so Naomi can have something to eat that evening. What a good guy, amen? Amen. You like Boaz now, don't you, right? But come on. I mean, honestly, come on. Who's the one orchestrating all of this stuff behind the scenes to make sure that Naomi and Ruth have what they need? Who is it? It's God, of course. And Naomi knows that full well, because later that evening, Ruth comes home, tells her about her amazing day, and listen to what she says. Look at her reaction in Ruth chapter 2, verse 20. 2:20. And Naomi said to her daughter-in-law, "May he," that's Boaz, "may Boaz be blessed by the Lord." Look what she says about the Lord. "May Boaz be blessed by the Lord, whose kindness has not forsaken the living or the dead." Look what she's saying about God now. She's saying that he's kind and that he hasn't forsaken them at all. Naomi understood that God was extending grace to her, that he was giving them more than they deserved in their desperate time of need. I mean, Ruth just happened to show up in the field of the best guy in Bethlehem. No, that doesn't just happen. God was guiding her, and Naomi knew that this blessing was the grace of God in her time of need. God had given her more than she deserved. And I tell you that, I land on that. I explain all of these ancient customs to you because I want you to understand one very clear thing. If we have strayed from God, if we find ourselves limping in the far country, God will give us more than we deserve for our journey back to Him. Amen? He will give us more than we deserve. Beyond making it possible to come home, God will make our journey home easier along the way. I mean, just giving us what we need would be grace, right? Because we don't deserve that. But God goes a step beyond that, several steps beyond that, and gives us more than we deserve for our journey back home. And that is what I call God's abundant grace, because he's so good to us. We know what abundant grace looked like for Naomi and Ruth. We saw it in the story. Boaz brought them under his protection, gave them more than enough so that they weren't scavenging the fields anymore. Who knows? I mean, abundant grace could look like a million different things for us on our journeys back to God. Have you ever experienced the abundant grace of God? Have you ever found yourself in a situation where you're in a far country and you need to get back to him? Along the way, has he demonstrated his grace and his faithfulness and his love and kindness to you in an abundant way? I get to hear these stories from people about how God makes the journey back to him easier, and they're so encouraging. Maybe for your journey back home, God surrounded you with supportive and loving Christian friends. They prayed for you. They supported you. They encouraged you as you were limping home back to a close relationship with God. Maybe they even held your hand as you stepped into that meeting that you really need to be a part of. Maybe they held your hand as you walked through the doors of a church, because that can be scary for folks who've been away for a while. You're afraid the roof's going to fall in on you. Maybe they were right there for you every step of the way, making your journey back to God easier. Do you know you didn't earn those friends, right? You know, you didn't necessarily deserve them. But that was God giving you his abundant grace to make your journey back to him easier. Maybe God just put you in the right place at the right time to talk to the right person, or to listen to something through the radio or a podcast, whatever. And in that moment, you heard that God actually wanted you to come back home. You weren't sure. And that God made sure you got that message. You know, you didn't earn that divine appointment, right? You didn't deserve it. And yet God, in that moment, met you where you were and gave you his abundant grace to make your journey back to him easier. That's the grace of God. Hear me on this. This is really what I want you to walk away with this morning. God will give us grace for the journey back home. He'll give us grace for the journey back home. Naomi wanted to get back to her life with God in the promised land. That's all she wanted. And so God was patient with her confused emotions. He didn't give her the zap she deserved. And at the same time, God gave her more than she deserved in terms of provision and blessing to make her journey home back easier. And all of that is grace. And I believe that God will do the same kind of stuff for us when we find ourselves struggling and lost in a far country. Do you believe that? Good. Remember that. I don't want this to happen to you. I don't. And I hope it doesn't, and I pray it doesn't. But you might at some point find yourself lost in a far country. Just remember that God will give you grace for the journey back home. Now, that's not going to happen to you because you love Jesus. The Holy Spirit's dwelling within you. But sometimes life goes off the rails, right? Yes. So you just remember that. For now, you're safe. You're snug right in the heart of God's kingdom, right next to him. The safest place to be on the planet is right next to God. And that's where you are. And so maybe the application for this message this morning, maybe the to-do item is this. If you know all of that about God, if you know that he's gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, abounding in love, if you know that he will give people grace for their journey back to him, then you need to tell someone that. I'm not kidding. You need to tell someone that. Because chances are pretty good you know someone who is lost in a far country right now. Maybe they just did this. Maybe they're even sitting right next to you. Don't look at the person next to you. That'd be awkward. But maybe this pleasant person has become bitter. And they're lost in a far country that's right up here with some cloudy thinking. You need to tell them that God is a God of grace. And that he'll give them grace for their journey back home. Hear me on this. They need to hear it. So you need to say it. That's how this works. And so, as we wrap up our time together today, I want us to focus on those folks who are wandering in a far country. Our worship leaders are going to come. They're going to lead us in a song that's going to affirm God's love for us. And while we do that, as we pray and as we sing this song, I want us to remember that God is a God of grace. I want us to thank him for that and bask in its awesomeness. Amen? Because it's awesome. But I also want us to ask him for an opportunity to talk to that person we know is lost in a far country. And I want us to ask him to use us to help show them the way home. Will you agree with me in prayer to that end? Let's stand together then and pray. Lord, we are so thankful for your grace. We rely on it and depend on it every day. We're aware of it. We know that the safest place on this planet is right next to you. We also know that sometimes we stray. Maybe it's for a moment. Maybe it's for years. Lord, thank you for the reminder in the story of Naomi that you are a God who gives us grace for our journey back home. We just want to celebrate that. But we also know that there are some folks around us who need to hear it. They've wandered from you. They're in a far country. They're in a mess. And they need to hear that you want them to come back home, that you will give them grace for that journey back home. And so, Lord, we're thinking about those folks today. in the far country right now. Lord, here's what we want. We want you to use us to help show those folks the way home. We know this stuff about you. We ask for a chance, an opportunity to talk to those folks and to tell them that you want them to come home and that you have plenty of grace, plenty of patience, plenty of blessing for them. Lord, we will hold their hands. We'll take them to those meetings. We'll walk them through the doors of a church. We will be right there with them. That's our heart, if you'll just give us the chance to do that. Lord, we ask for that opportunity in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thanks for joining us online to watch one of our messages. I hope it was encouragement to you. Before you click off the tab and continue with your day, I want to invite you to partner with us with your financial blessing and offering and gifts to the Lord. You can find our giving button right above us on the upper right-hand side of the screen. We hope that we're able to continue to bless you in the future. God bless.